Hi, everyone. Thank you for tuning in. This is Julian Morales. I'm the writer, director, producer of One Bad Day. So this movie has been in the process for over 2 years. I first started writing it when I was in film school. Basically, we called it Film Production 1. And during then, our instructor and also the head of the program was telling us about when we got to the end in Film Production 4 that we'd be able to write bigger projects and use more production standard equipment and all that, and just really excited me. So I immediately started thinking about this story. So when I finished film school, I got together with friends of mine, or fellow film students of mine, and we got together and we made this crime saga, basically, that we all worked very hard on over 2 weekends, and I'm insanely proud of the work that they did and that we did together. So shooting this opening title sequence, I really wanted it to set up the tone for this, the movie, of it being this very gritty and dark and stylistic crime drama. And we shot this in Miami near Bayside, me and Francie Moore, who plays my partner, Detective McQueen. And then here we are introduced to Luna Rivera's character of Maggie, who's basically the leader of the bank robbery team that she has assembled. And I really wanted the sequences of her of her giving her confession in this interrogation room. I really wanted it to echo the style of like old school noirs, with it being very contrasted and stylistically simple compared to the rest of the movie, because it's very locked down, not a whole lot of handheld. And, you know, there's just people sitting at a table where the rest of the movie is very handheld. It's in black and white. And I really wanted it to feel stylistically different from the scenes in the interrogation room. Because with the flashbacks, you know, with it being in black and white, everything just feels so much more hostile and dire and dangerous versus the safe setting of the interrogation room with the two detectives. So here's Carolina Sparatella as Nikki, and then in the back there is Alina Graf as Lynn. The Lynn's character, she's the medic of the team and the more empathetic of the group. And Carolina, she's basically the hothead of the group. She's volatile, has a very hostile demeanor about her. And filming this scene was particularly tricky. For the scenes inside of the car, we basically just drove around in my neighborhood in like circles, basically, because I didn't want it to be a visual effects heavy scene. I didn't want them to be parked exactly. I wanted it to feel as immersive as possible for the actors and for the viewer. To tell that they're not just driving around circles, I overblew the windows. So you can really tell the details of what's happening outside. But there was one day we were just driving around in circles, which was a challenge for the actors, especially for Carolina, because she had to perform and drive at the same time. And then I had another day where I drove around with GoPros on the camera, driving around in the rain to try to match the dialogue scenes inside the car. And then stylistically, what I did visually is I added... we couldn't exactly afford actual 35mm, 60mm film stock, so we shot this on Canon cameras, and some select shots were done on my iPhone and on GoPros, but I basically added a film grain effect. I wanted the interrogation room scenes to be a little bit more cleaner than the flashback scenes, so I tried to make it... look as if it was shot on 35mm in color, so it could feel a little bit more secure and stable. And then the flashback scenes, I had to try to mimic the look of black and white 16mm that you would see in like Darren Aronofsky films or even Nolan's first movie Following. And Nolan was a pretty big influence in the editing of the movie in regards to intercutting different scenes that take place in different timelines. Just to add more of a suspense and keeping up the pacing of the movie. And here we're introduced to Timothy Kalesnat's Marty, who's basically the mobster that the team works for. And then right beside him is Andre as Leon, who's basically Marty's right-hand man. He's his bodyguard, he's his confidant. He trusts him with his life, essentially. So he's always by his side. And for this sequence, I really wanted it to feel... I mean, I mentioned before that I wanted the flashback scenes to feel stylistically different than the interrogation room scenes in the present. But for the scenes, especially in the field, I really wanted it to evoke the feeling of a Eastwood Western, something you'd see in a Leone film, Eastwood film, or even... and in the black and white, it gives it a little bit of a Kurosawa edge. But so I tried to do that with having as much wides as possible, with having a good amount of standoff moments. The character Leon, who's kind of the latest addition to the script in regards to the drafts I've written, I really modeled him after gunslinger archetypes you'd see in old school Westerns, with him... with his weapon of choice being a six-shooter and always being ready to draw, you could say, at a moment's notice. This scene really shows what the core of the story is to me, because... even though it's a crime drama and it's about a bank robbery gone wrong, and as you know, these Western elements or crime drama elements that I mentioned, at the core of the story, it really is about this group of friends who are really having the worst falling out right now after the heist went so incredibly wrong that that we don't get to see but is alluded to. And it just causes the bonds between the three of them to really collapse. And I really wanted to sell that with a lot of handheld and close-ups and shallow depth of field and the close-ups. And I really encouraged the actors to be as emotionally raw and honest as they could when arguing with each other, because they had a deep trust with each other before the events of the movie, but now that trust is completely gone. So it's very emotionally hard for them to talk to each other, even look at each other now. And it really... felt that the handheld and very close up look really helps sell that emotion to the viewer. Hey, it's me. Hey, Lynn. You're out later than usual.
Yeah, sorry. Work's keeping me here longer. You won't be home for dinner.
That's a shame. It's pizza night, and you know how she loves that.
Yeah, I do. Can I talk to her? Hey, Munchkin. How was school today?
Good. I drew a picture today for you.
Really? Wow, I can't wait to see it.
It's,
No, don't tell me. I want to see it in person. So I could be surprised and give you a big hug and kiss for it.
Okay.
I love you more than anything. Okay?
Okay. Goodbye, Mommy.
Goodbye.
And then this scene has an interesting backstory to it. So when we were in pre-production for the movie, I met with Luna, Carolina, and Alina on a day we all met together for a table read of the movie, and it was one of the early drafts of the script that we were reading together. But afterwards, Carolina, she basically noticed that her character was very, at the time of the draft that we were reading, her character is very one note, one dimensional. She was basically just like the stereotypical crazy person in the heist that has to ruin everything. And so she brought that to my attention, and she basically asked, very straightforward, like, could you just make her a little bit more human? And I realized that was something that I overlooked in her character, because I only saw her as like a source of tension and not as a, just as a person. So I went back and I wrote this scene to really just show her that she is, you know, like human, like everyone else in the story. Is just because she feels remorse and she feels regret for the actions that she took at the bank heist. And it's weighing very heavily on her. So if anything, this, you know, thanks to her, it just added more weight to the character, because it's just showing just how much is going on with her psychologically and why she acts the way that she does throughout the story. Which I was very thankful for adding that to the story.
Leon, I'm not talking about that now. Probably not ever, so just quit while you're ahead.
Like how you won't talk about Coringle? Sorry. Drink?
See? Now you're being awful.
Well, especially, well, the thing that was great about adding his character, besides having, you know, the cool gunslinger, is that this whole sequence before the sequence that's going to start now, I really wanted to take a break from the tension and all that. I mean, there's still tension, but I really wanted to slow the movie down a bit and show the three main characters show them as people, as who they are when they're not, you know, in the middle of arguing or in the middle of a crime or anything like that. I wanted the viewer to really see them at their most emotionally raw and vulnerable before things start to get really bad in the next sequence that's about to start.
What's he doing?
The point in the car.
Stay here, Nikki. I've got this. 5 minutes and we're out of here.
And this sequence came about in some rewrites I did in the middle of production, because we shot this on one weekend and I basically got overwhelmed under the weight of this project and how like massive it is compared to other things I've done. So, and I wasn't really mentally prepared for that, unfortunately. So we had to do the reshoots 2 weeks later. And in the 2 weeks, I added this new sequence into it that wasn't here before, like, the outcome of the sequence happened much quicker and wasn't, and didn't feel very earned or exciting or suspenseful at all, really. So when I went back to the script and wanted to add more to it, I came up with a sequence so that, well, for starters, Maggie, her character, the whole movie is her basically like realizing that she's not in control of things as much as she thought she was. And in the original script, that point didn't really come across, I feel, very well. So with this new sequence, it really just drove that home, because she thinks that she has this under control and she can get it under control. But everything just spirals out of her control. And it's something that she's not used to, because usually she's very methodical. She plans things very meticulously. But in this whole movie, she's basically on improv. And And it's something that's based, that's just chipping away at her resolve, that she can't control anything.
I need you to back off and let us finish talking. Talk? Talk about what? That I'm unstable? A dead weight? Are you gonna leave me behind so I can take all the heat?
The crime saga genre is a very crowded genre. It's not exactly in need of more films, so I knew that I needed to put my own spin on it and not rip so much from the movies that were inspiring me. So besides the editing style and the cinematography style, I knew I wanted to portray violence in a different way than most movies of this nature do, because usually it's very action heavy and it's choreographed in a way that's very fun and eye pleasing to watch, which I definitely enjoy and I love. But I wanted to do something different with this movie, and I felt like what I needed to do was portray violence and gun violence in a way that's a lot more realistic and disturbing, that you don't even really get to see the impacts, you could say, of the violence, but you do see how it affects the characters psychologically and emotionally, which is where I feel is where the violence needed to be for this story. Where so much of the story is about choices and consequence, that the violence needs to echo that as well as the character choices.
Understand why I do everything for them.
You have 5 seconds to explain to me why you just killed the only people helping us.
They weren't fucking. Get us the hell out of here now.
Okay. Let's take a phone. What about?
Get in the car.
I served. Served in an infantry unit. We knocked doors down together, took enemy fire. It's a bond that no one is ever gonna understand. So what happened to your partners?
I really utilized the GoPro camera that I had. It basically just drove around and I picked different angles that the GoPro could use, and I basically just used the GoPro in a car mount attachment that I got with it, and just stuck it in a bunch of places that I thought would look interesting to have a camera on while driving. This sequence here is my personal favorite, and it's a sequence that I've always been insanely proud of. Everything in the sequence I felt just went so right in regards to the actors, who did phenomenal, and then the technical choices that were made were also, I felt, just really made this sequence a home run for me. Because originally this wasn't going to be a oneer, this part. It was going to, I was going to shoot it the traditional way with master scene methods and coverage and all that, but with what goes on, we kind of couldn't really stick around this place for long, and so basically me and the actors basically came up with the idea of making this whole thing a oneer, which would speed up the shooting of it, and also dramatically it just made this feel so much more real and in the moment. I felt it feels like you're a fourth person there with them arguing with each other. And it was something that I was very nervous of doing because again, it wasn't originally planned to be a oneer, but the actors were just completely game for this new decision, and they just completely brought it. And I'm so insanely proud of them for the sequence because they just killed it. Because again, it wasn't all supposed to be this one shot, but they ended up being able to do it anyway. So I didn't really use slow-mo in this movie, except, and I saved it for this particular moment because I really wanted this sequence to feel almost like nightmarish for both Maggie and Nikki's characters, because Nikki's done something that's completely unforgivable and she can't take back, and Maggie just witnessed the death of her best friend, and now she just killed her best friend. So this is a very traumatic moment for all of them, and the slow-mo and the harshness of the lighting really illustrates that. And here she's brought back to the color timeline. So basically you can kind of say that color represents just truth and light in regards to, in contrast to the black and white, because in black and white she's, you know, it's in the past and she's still in the delusion that she can control things. But then once her friends are dead and she's getting arrested, the color comes back on. And then the rest of the movie is, and then the parts that are in color is her confession, essentially. And she's basically facing the hard truth that she was responsible for all this mayhem and chaos and death that happened. And it's something that she's going to have to learn to live with. Bringing home the theme of choices and consequences, because the choices that were made throughout the story led to this outcome of everyone dying in her incarceration.
Thank you for your cooperation, Maggie. Your testimony will help clear things up. We'll be transferring to holding now.
Do me one last favor. Keep Lynn out of this. She didn't hurt anybody, and her daughter does not need to know about this. This was just one bad day, but she didn't do anything wrong. Never hurt her soul. I did this. I deserve this. Not her.
You can't promise anything. We should have thought of that before you started this.
And that's it. So thank you for watching. Crime drama is one of my favorite genres to watch, and I really wanted to make this movie to homage those movies. And finding confidence can be hard, but if you can find it, the confidence to just go with your gut and make your passion projects, then I can guarantee you can do it. It'll be hard because if I, you know, like I mentioned, I had to do some research, so I had some hardships in making this movie, but all throughout, the love for filmmaking and for making this movie with this group of people was enough to make me stick through it to the end. So hope my words of wisdom will inspire you. But in the end, just thank you for watching, like, and subscribe to my channel for more, and stay tuned. Thank you.